Hello, I'm Mark Montgomery. Welcome to The Link. And today on our final radio show, Canada is lobbying hard to become a member of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. It's called the most ambitious free trade bloc in the world, but not everyone thinks joining it is a good idea. Then, what do Vincent van Gogh and Canadian high school students have in common? A unique contest tries to find out.
Like, he never gave up. Like, he was going through some pretty intense stuff, but he never gave up. He held on to his dream, so I hope to do the same.
As a once-in-a-lifetime Van Gogh exhibition comes to the nation's capital, the Dutch embassy reached out to Canadian children. They wanted to find out how young people see the Netherlands' most famous artist. And we'll have more from Ottawa and our correspondent Amanda Pfeffer. Also today, we'll hear about an effort to protect the calving grounds of an important herd of northern Canadian caribou. And we'll talk to one of several leading scientists who have signed a letter of support for the plan. Those are items coming up on this edition of The Link. As Canadian as bacon, the beaver, Newfie screech, the maple leaf, prairie wheat, Pacific salmon, and the Great White North. Had a little bit of trouble with that today. I don't know why, but glad to have you with us on the show. We're going to start out with an important story that Canada is going to join negotiations for what is a proposed Trans-Pacific Partnership. And if Canada and Mexico were to join, the talks could create a free trade market of over 500 million people in Asia, Oceania, and the Americas. Corporations want the so-called TPP, but some citizens and farmers groups are not so sure it will be good for ordinary Canadians. And to find out why, we have reached Stuart True, trade campaigner with the Council of Canadians. Mr. True, hello and welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, Mark. How are you?
I am very well. Free traders now are say, joining the TPP will open up huge markets for Canadian companies. What's your view on that?
Well, I think huge is a pretty big exaggeration in this case. The benefits for Canada, even for Canadian export sectors, which are the main proponents, I would say, like you said at the top there, the main corporations looking for Canada to enter the talks, I would say the benefits are actually quite slim if you look at some of the assessments that have been done. One assessment, for example, out of the United States from a think tank that's actually supportive of the talks says Canada's looking at about a benefit, you know, by 2025 of 0.1% of our GDP. You know, that's not a lot of money, even 10 years into when they hope to have a deal signed. So in terms of market access opportunities, the TPP doesn't actually offer too much for Canada. The reason groups in Canada are concerned are the other areas that don't really have much to do with trade, but that will require Canada to make significant public policy changes just to get that seat at the table. And so that's really where the concerns come up.
Well, what are some of those public policy initiatives you're talking about?
Well, sure. To give you one example, we've seen it crop up in the Canada-European Union free trade negotiations as well. These have been underway for 2 years and are actually quite advanced. But it's the issue of intellectual property protections for big drug manufacturers. And so a lot of these drug companies, the big pharma, as some groups call them, they're based in Europe, they're based in the United States, and they're always looking for more protection, you know, for their intellectual property, for the, you know, the patents. They want longer patents on drugs. They want more protection for the research that they put into them. And the result of these policy changes that the U.S. is asking of TPP countries in the trade negotiations will be potentially in Canada to increase the price of drugs. It slows down the introduction of generic drugs, for example, onto the market, which is a reason we can keep drug costs down in Canada. And not only that, but developing country members of the TPP are concerned that it's going to undermine their ability to import cheaper drugs. Mm-hmm. The more power you give and the more, you know, corporate control essentially you give to these big pharmaceutical companies through these trade deals, you know, the more expensive public health systems become in these countries. And I think it's another example of how trade deals, you know, increasingly these new generation of trade deals, they call them, are not so much about opening markets, I would say, as protecting limited vested interest groups. And the TPP is a good example of that with respect to pharmaceutical companies.
Now, another thing that Canada has is supply management systems, such as our dairy producers are protected by that kind of thing, for example. What would this TPP mean in terms of that and how that may affect producers and consumers, actually?
Well, that's a very good question, and it's one that our government hasn't really answered yet. From the news reports we've seen, there are some conditions to Canada joining. So Canada and Mexico were invited into the talks by Obama at the G20 this week. But they were invited with conditions, and one of them was we're not allowed to make any changes to chapters that are finished. And that'll be the case when Canada finally does enter the talks in December. They're estimating we won't be at the table till December. Whatever's decided up to that point, we will actually not be able to make any changes to it. So the Harper government has essentially signed a blank check in many respects to the Obama government, which is leading these talks. But there's been speculation that we're going to have to make upfront promises on supply management. Now, this is a decades-old system in Canada where milk, dairy, poultry, and egg production is regulated. It's regulated for consumption. So we produce what we eat. And as a result of that, we have stable prices in Canada. And we balance the needs of farmers with the needs of consumers. And so, you know, in those sectors in Canada, farmers can actually make a decent living, a living wage in a sense. Whereas around the world, similar dairy farmers aren't so lucky. And so I think it's a system we should be prizing in Canada and not trying to sacrifice. But, of course, there are countries at the table. The United States is one of them. New Zealand is another, that want that system dismantled because it does exclude their dairy products, in some cases, from the Canadian market. It puts up high tariffs on those in order to protect our domestic, essentially our buy local milk system here in Canada. So, is it worth dismantling that system just to get a seat at this table? I would say absolutely not. Again, the gains in terms of other export sectors, whether it's grains or forestry products, I don't think it's worth throwing dairy farmers, chicken farmers under the bus for those kinds of small gains.
Well, Mr. True, we've certainly seen other examples in free trade agreements that Canada has embarked upon. I mean, free traders will say that Canada has prospered under the deal between Canada, U.S. and Mexico, but we certainly have seen a lot of controversy, too, in some of that. What's your overall view of these kinds of massive free trade agreements?
Well, I think the experience, the free trade regime, the free trade era of the past 30 years has not lived up to the promises we heard back in, back in the original Canada-U.S. free trade debates of the late 80s. You know, we were promised jobs, we were promised public services would never be compromised. And what's happened globally, though, is that, inequality has actually been increasing, not only within Canada, but between countries as well. So we're seeing free trade has been good at creating wealth, absolutely, but the wealth is not being distributed. It's getting concentrated at the top. And we're at the point where these new free trade agreements, the Harper government's free trade agenda and this next generation of trade deals actually don't try and kind of level the playing field or help distribute wealth more. They're actually concentrating, again, they're just helping the vested interests that have benefited from this regime. And again, we can look at Hollywood in the case of copyright protections, or we can look at the big pharma we were talking about early, pharmaceutical firms. These trade deals are really about locking in corporate control over how the economy, the global economy, is governed. And I think it's time in Canada that we reassess the effects NAFTA might have had on Canada with respect to other public policies that really don't have much to do with trade.
Well, Mr. True, thank you very much for talking to us today about this.
I appreciate it. Thanks, Mark.
That is Stuart True. He's a trade campaigner with the Council of Canadians. And for those who would like more information about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, we'll post some links on our site, rcinet.ca/the link.
Hello. You're listening to The Link. With my friend Mark.
Now, how could you not love that? I mean, really. Yes, my friend Mark. It is me, Mark Montgomery. This is The Link. You know, a unique exhibition of Dutch painter Vincent van Gogh in Ottawa this summer is the inspiration behind an equally unique contest for young Canadian school children. I, Vincent, is an online contest for students to explore Vincent van Gogh's work through their own eyes. It's sponsored by the Dutch Embassy in Ottawa. The ambassador himself showed up this week at an Ottawa high school to take a look at their work. And as our Ottawa correspondent Amanda Pfeffer tells us, the students literally rolled away on their prizes.
Hundreds of people attended opening night at the National Art Gallery for a show called Van Gogh, Up Close. 45 original works collected from around the world, some never before seen in public. Mark Mayer is the gallery director.
We're well over 10,000 tickets sold already online, so that is a record for us.
But many Canadians will never make the trip, and for the Dutch Embassy, that's a missed opportunity, particularly for aspiring young artists. Wim Gertz is the ambassador of the Netherlands in Canada.
I think that every child, Canadian or Dutch, deserves to get familiar with Van Gogh because he was one of the greatest artists ever. And it's just great, you know, to be exposed, you know, to his life and to his art.
And so the embassy set up an online resource for art teachers across the country and invited students to participate in a contest called I, Vincent. They were asked to imagine painting the world through Vincent van Gogh's eyes.
I like how you painted that face.
I like your stars for me.
And it took off. Hundreds of students across the country participated.
Mars looks exactly like the
I know, it looks exactly
I remember
like
when
that.
You... My name is Mari Steele. I'm 16 and I'm in grade 10 at Sir Robert Borden High School. This is a painting that Van Gogh did, but I split it up into the foreground, middle grounds, and background. Yeah, I used cardboard for it and layered a lot of paint. All the colors I did, I mixed myself.
Mary Steele and many of the students in Ms. Karen McNeil Barclay's art class at Sir Robert Borden High School have reproduced some of Van Gogh's most famous paintings, each with the student's very personal stamp. The painting The Bedroom, for instance, with a skateboard leaning up against the bed. Self-portraits of themselves in the Van Gogh style.
I'm Samara Aiken. I'm 16, and I'm in grade 10 at Sir Robert Borden High School.
Samara Aiken took the painting Almond Branch in Bloom and painted it on a teapot for her mother.
I love tea. And this is one of my favorite paintings by Van Gogh, so I decided that I'd paint my favorite painting on a teapot.
Starry, starry night. Paint your palette blue and gray.
Van Gogh is one of the most popular artists in the world. His art is reproduced on posters and postcards. Even in the modern era, music is still being written about him.
Sketch the trees and the daffodils.
But part of the cult around Van Gogh is his tragic personal story, his battle with mental illness, the lack of recognition, the violent end by gunshot, the perfect draw for young people, according to Natalie Manta with the National Art Gallery.
Incredible artists that lived so shortly that created amazing artwork. And I think that the interest resides in that.
My name is Jamie Ford, and I'm 15 years old, and I'm grade 10 at Sir Robert Borden. I thought it was really interesting to know that he did most of his paintings in the last couple of years of his life. And I actually didn't know that he was so mentally upset, I guess. I definitely appreciate him more. Like, I didn't realize how much emotion he put into all of his paintings. Like, and his paintings have such an earthy, natural feel to them. And, like, I love his work.
I'm Natalia Vogelsang. I'm 15 years old. Well, this is one of the paintings he did when he moved into the south of France. He actually moved to the south of France because he kind of had a big fight with his brother Theo, and he moved there with Paul Gauguin.
They're so eloquent in the way that they speak about the art. They could be guides at the gallery.
Jamie Ford said she loved the process, but she'd love to win the contest as well.
That would be spectacular. Like, it would be great. It was so fun, the contest. Like, it just gave us an extra motivation to do our best. It was wonderful.
Good morning. And you've been talking about Van Gogh?
At that moment, the classroom gets a surprise guest. It's